think we're ready. You can hear me okay, guys? So, hi, everyone. I know we're running on a tight schedule today. So, welcome to today's session as part of the Cambridge Live Experience. The next session is named Lost in the COVID Maze, Assessment for Learning is Your GPS. Fantastic title. My name is Johnny Frank, and I work for Michigan Language Assessment, a not-for-profit collaboration between Cambridge Assessment English and the University of Michigan. Presenting this session, we have two fantastic regional colleagues of mine, Alberto Costa and Pablo Toledo. Alberto is Senior Assessment Services Manager Americas for Cambridge Assessment English. He has worked as a teacher, teacher trainer, and course tutor for the CELTA, iCELT, and DELTA, and continuing professional development for teachers is one of his key interests. Pablo Toledo is Assessment Services Manager for the Southern Cone and Andes for Cambridge Assessment English. He's an English teacher and a teacher trainer based in Argentina. He has managed remote teaching projects and has worked in ELT publishing and for an English language newspaper. Like most of you, we're working from home, but we're aiming to give you the best experience we can. We're relying on home Wi-Fi, so please bear with us if we have any issues. And just some housekeeping. So before we start, here are a few suggestions to help you get the most out of today's session. We recommend headphones if you can to get better quality audio and so you can hear better. Try not to have anything else running, particularly programs like Skype, and switch off any of the programs that you're able to. Don't worry if the picture is a bit blurry at first. It will get better. That's just how live streaming goes, but it shouldn't take too long. During the webinar, you'll need to be able to use the chat box, which you should be able to see on the right-hand side of the taskbar or the toolbar on your screen. Please use the chat if you want to type any comments, and please use the question, the Q&A box, for any questions that you'd like our presenters to answer at the end of their presentation. If it's something that we can answer right away, then we'll do that for you, and we'll keep some of the other questions to be able to ask Pablo and Alberto at the end. So please don't worry if your answer isn't questioned straight away. We've got people moderating and checking those things. And we might also ask you to use the chat box or polls for activities. I think there might be a poll coming up in this session, a poll or two. In terms of certificates, we will be issuing them at the end of the session. And the certificate and a link to the recording will be sent to you afterwards. So don't worry about the certificates either. That's enough from me. I'm going to hand over to colleagues and very good friends, Alberto and Pablo, and say to you all, please enjoy the next 30 or 40 minutes. I'll see you at the end for some questions and answers.
Thank you very much, Johnny, for that lovely introduction. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are.
Hello, everyone. Again, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. I would like to thank Johnny for his great introduction. Thank you very much, Johnny. And I would like to thank the team that is supporting us here and to thank my colleague Pablo, with whom I've been presenting webinars here with Cambridge Assessment English. And it has been a great pleasure to do research and to present together. So for the topic of this session, Lost in the COVID Maze, Assessment for Learning is Your GPS. We are going to be sharing with you some experiences, and also we are going to be sharing some thoughts about assessment for learning, right? So this is the title of the session, and I hope we can give you some sort of direction in terms of where you're going for your assessment of learners during those times. In terms of the agenda for this presentation, we have three main topics that we are going to cover. We're going to start discussing the current scenario. There will be a brief description. We are going to talk about assessment for learning. That is Pablo's part, which he has beautifully organized. And then we're going to talk about some practical ideas for assessment for learning in use. So, we're going to start with the situation where many of us teachers have found ourselves at the beginning of the COVID situation. This is what the current scenario looked like, or still looks like, for many of us. And when we look at ourselves and we position ourselves and we see this image there of the maze, the first question that comes to our mind is, okay, where are we going? What's the way out? I need some sense of direction. So hopefully we're gonna try and provide you with some sort of direction for, you know, to try and rescue out of the maze. Everything started in March for most people around the world. Some countries, the situation started a bit earlier. So we see here the teacher confidently standing in the classroom, teaching their learners. And then suddenly, most teachers around the world started shifting and teaching from home, teaching through the computer. And what we have noticed is this hasn't been a very seamless transition for most teachers. So in April, Pablo and I were delivering a global webinar entitled Resilience, Teaching in Tough Times. And in this webinar, we talked about this newspaper article that was published in my country, in Brazil. By the way, I'm speaking from Brazil. Pablo is speaking from Buenos Aires in Argentina. And the newspaper article read that many teachers had issues with the sudden change of reality. As I said, not a seamless transition. So teachers had never imagined that they would be doing home office, for example, because teaching has always been associated with the teacher in the classroom. So they were facing anxiety from parents. Also, they were still trying to get used with the new context, like having a camera, editing videos, developing a number of strategies, especially related to technology. Also, many teachers improvising their studio at home, getting help from their family members and partners, and also struggling with the production of material and recording things more than once in order to get it right, and with one intention, to deliver the best they could to their learners, right? Later in June, we can see that the situation changed a bit. So in this blog post, we see that with the learning that teachers managed to get from the COVID situation, they noticed that many of the points that they considered in their learning curve in teaching remotely, they're going to make use of in the new reality when they return to their classes. So for example, incorporating more and more digital tools in their teaching, whether remotely or face-to-face, will be one consequence of this situation with the COVID. And then the blog post mentions this survey that they carried out with 500 members of the Microsoft Education community. They are representing teachers and institutional leaders from around the world. And they have found that 61% of the people interviewed said that they expect to begin the next school year starting in some countries, in a hybrid learning environment. So there is a mixture of in-person and remote teaching, and 87% said that they expect to use the technology more than before in their classrooms when face-to-face classroom resumes. So we can see here a difference in mindset between April and June when teachers have incorporated their learning. So it seems that for some people, we cannot generalize, for some people, they are sort of in the maze, but they seem to be seeing a light at the end of the tunnel. For other people, they might still be at the beginning of the maze. And then here is a poll that we would like to carry out with you. So where do you think you are at the moment? Are you out of the maze and comfortable? Are you on the way out of the maze and struggling? Or are you still lost in the maze? There's no right or wrong answer to this. So we would just like to check. We would like to get a sense of where you think you are at the moment. Are you out of the maze and comfortable? Are you on the way out of the maze and struggling? Or are you lost in the maze? So we are going to be looking at the results very, very soon. we can see that 54% of the participants here are on the way out of the maze and struggling. I think this reflects, Pablo, the article that we just talked about. Some people are already at a very, very nice situation. They are out of the maze and comfortable. Congratulations to you guys. We are all looking forward to getting there. But we still have some people lost in the maze, right? So this leads us to consider where we are going next. So we need for this moment some sort of direction. Perhaps many of us are now facing those questions, right? So the first question that comes to our mind when we are in the maze is, where are my students in terms of their learning? Then we have another question, right? Because we are in the maze. And where are we in relation to our learning objectives? Many of us started the academic year with some objectives in mind and aiming to cover those objectives, but we have to make changes. We have to make adjustments along the way. In terms of objectives, we still have another question, which is question 3. Can I meet my original learning objectives? And last but not least, we have here the final question, what can I do to meet those learning objectives? I'm sure those questions are in many of our minds here, but I think I'm gonna leave this huge challenge to my colleague Pablo, right? Pablo will bring the GPS to give us a sense of direction. Pablo, you have the challenge.
Well, thank you for that, Alberto. And what we need is, as Alberto was saying, a GPS. And when I say, and that GPS is going to be assessment for learning. We're going to talk about what assessment for learning means and how it can be the GPS to guide you through the maze, hopefully out of the maze and to a bright future beyond it. So, but before we do that, let's talk about what a GPS does and how good assessment is like a GPS. So in assessment, we usually talk about three classic functions. There are three things that, classic things that we do with assessment. And likewise, there are different things that we do with a GPS. The first question you can ask a GPS is, where am I? So I just, here you can see on my screen, I click on where am I, and it is showing me that I am at, like most of you, I am at home. That is where my home, where my house is in Buenos Aires. So diagnostic assessment is the kind of assessment that tells you where you are, what things you know, what things you don't, what things you need to reinforce. So basically, the only question that you expect from a diagnostic test and the forms of diagnostic assessment is to tell you where you are, just like when you check on your phone. Now, but another thing that we do on the phone is, if I want to go from my house to this other address, this red flag, which happens to be the Cambridge Assessment English office in Buenos Aires. So it tells me two things. Or maybe more. It tells me that I am here, so this is where you are. Tells me that I would like to be here. And it tells me that this is how far I am. It gives me a distance between one point and the other. And this is analog to what we do with summative assessment. Summative assessment tells me where I am right now, the things I know, the things I don't know, my strengths, my weaknesses. It tells me where I am in relation to my learning objectives. So for instance, if you think of a Cambridge assessment or a Cambridge English exam, if you think of a B1 preliminary, so the results of that test are going to tell you where you are, how you're doing, what things you know, what things you need to reinforce, but it tells you where you are in relation to the definition of B1. So B1 is where I would like to be, and the results of that test tell me where I am in relation to those goals. Just like a test that you would do during a course or at the end of a course to show whether learners have learned the things that you expected them to learn during the course or not. But a good GPS actually does more than that, because what you can see here is that a GPS actually gives me more information. A GPS tells me that I am here. It tells me that I would like to be in this other place, and it gives me the distance, but it gives me a route. It gives me alternatives for how to get from where I am to where I want to go. Not just here and here, but from here to here, this is the route. These are some alternative routes. This is the fastest, this is the best, this is the cheapest, whatever. So that would be similar to what we do with format, to what we expect from formative assessment. Because formative assessment, or assessment for learning, tells me where I am in relation to my learning objectives and what I need to do to get there. So good formative assessment is not just this you know, this you don't, and you should, but it's this you know, this you don't. We would have expected you to know this much by now. So this is where, but to actually get to where you want to go, these are some ideas, these are some suggestions, these are some things that you need to bear in mind. So normally we think in terms of, traditionally we think of formative and summative assessment a bit like these two things, where formative assessment is like the cooks who are tasting the meal as they prepare it, and summative is like the people at the restaurant. Remember those? A restaurant, it's a place where you used to go and they prepared food for you. That is not your dining room at home. When the customers are eating the food at the restaurant, that's it. That is the summative thing. The food is done and they are passing some judgment. Now, so we think of formative, summative as alternatives, but actually it is more useful to think of formative and summative as kind of two ends of a spectrum. So you can think of some kinds of assessment as being more towards the formative and some being towards the summative, whereas actually they work together. Formative is ongoing assessment as you do it. It guides what happens next. So yeah, we need to leave this in the boiler for another minute. Put a little bit more salt. Not enough of this, too much of that. You can change what happens next. And it is a kind of purpose. It tells you where to go, it gives you a direction. A summative assessment normally comes at the end of a period of study. It evaluates what has happened before, and it assumes that you are going to continue studying, but that this particular stage is closed. And it is a kind of judgment. You have reached an objective or not. Can we live without one or the other? Can we teach without one or the other? Not really. And that is the point of assessment for learning. Assessment for learning is not formative assessment, good, summative assessment, bad. Assessment for learning is how all of these work together. So assessment becomes formative when the evidence is actually used to adapt the teaching work to meet the needs. So what actually makes assessment formative is not when it happens or what kind of activity you do to assess, but actually that you're going to use that information to adapt the teaching, and that adaptation is going to help you help the learners get where they want to go. It is not about what kind of activity you do, when you do it, etc., etc. It's about what you do with it. You can have great assessment tools, but if you don't use the information that you gather, the feedback that you gather, to actually make a change, it's not going to be formative at all. It's just going to happen at a moment where you would have expected formative assessment, but it was not a formative experience. So assessment for learning comes as the idea, the notion of assessment for learning was very strongly formulated in the UK by the Assessment Reform Group. They gathered at the end of the 90s, they produced a number of documents and publications and research. It was a group of top researchers, many of them working for Cambridge Assessment, many of them involved with the Department of Education at the University of Cambridge. These are five principles that they identified as characterizing the approach of assessment for learning. So the first one is that it is assessment for learning when learners receive effective feedback. Effective feedback is meaningful, is feedback that I can understand. It is specific, it tells me specifically, this is your strength, this is your weakness, this was the problem, this is where you're good. It is timely, it comes at the right moment, not 5 months later or before I need it, and it is future focused. It is not about what I did that was good or bad, it is about what I can do that will get me where I need to go. Learners, in assessment for learning, learners are actively involved in their learning and assessment. They know how they will be assessed, they know on what they will be assessed, they participate in the assessment process very actively, and they reflect on the assessment results, on they reflect on the feedback. If you do a summative test at the end of secondary school and you never look at those results, you never revise it, you never give your learners an opportunity to go back to the classroom because that was the first time they ever had an English test, what is the use of that? If you do it at the end of 1 year, but they come back next year and they can use those results, or the teacher that has them next year can use those results, that is summative assessment that actually has a formative purpose. Teaching, it is assessment for learning if the teaching adjusts on the results of the assessment. So good teaching is responsive. We know that. Good teaching is about communication. If you are just teaching to the walls and you don't respond to whatever happens or whatever your learners need, you just carry on with lesson one, lesson two, lesson three, that is not great teaching, is it? And good teaching decisions look at a broad evidence base. How do you know if you are going to stick around and continue insisting on the subject that you've been teaching on one particular topic, whatever it is, or if you are ready to, or if your learners are ready to move on to the next? Well, you need to look at a number of evidence. You need to look at formative assessment. Maybe it's time for a small mini summative test or a quiz. Maybe it is time to look at their faces and see if they look confused, but it has to be a broad evidence base. You need to look at different kinds of evidence. The fourth principle of formative of assessment for learning is to acknowledge the impact of assessment on motivation and self-esteem. So we know that whatever kind of assessment we do, and basically anything that we do in a human interaction, is going to have an impact. It's going to be received in a particular way. And assessment is something that usually in an educational context has implications, so it has a strong impact. Can be positive, can be negative. The key to look at is if we reinforce positive mindsets, the attitude that assessment is information that can actually help you get where you want to go. And it's not about you have failed. It is about these are the areas that you need to improve, and these are the things that you have actually done really well. And also to acknowledge the impact on identities. If you tell your student you failed, it is very different to tell a student you have failed from you are a failure, that would be really bad, would it? To you have done really well in these things, you are doing good, you are making progress on these things, you are not quite there yet, and these are things that you need to focus on. What does that do to a learner? What does that do to their experience of learning? And finally, the fifth principle, learners assess themselves and understand how to improve. Peer assessment, self-assessment. Good feedback is actionable. Good feedback is always something that you can work with, that you can move forward with. And self and peer assessment, where you look at your own work and you assess it, or when you look at the work of a peer and you look at how they're doing, those things are really important and super important for assessment for learning. Now, choices, 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 because we are basically working with two kinds of assessment, and this is a good moment to look at the strengths and weaknesses of each of those two. So teacher-led classroom assessment, which is usually traditionally associated with more of the formative end or where the teacher actually has more input, has strengths and weaknesses. What would be the not so, what are the areas that teacher-led assessment usually is not as strong as? Validity, the issues of are we actually assessing what we want to assess, that depends on what each teacher does, and if there is no one else to review it, what happens? Reliability and bias, is a teacher paying more importance to one area than another? Is a teacher assessing actually And what happens with the assessment that I do and the assessment that Alberto does? Are we assessing to the same standards? Recognition, is that going to be recognized by other teachers, other schools, other countries? The assessment workload, assessment can be a lot of work for a teacher if a teacher is expected to design a test, write a test, correct the test and all that. And then assessment literacy. There are a lot of issues involved in designing assessment that are very technical, that you need to know about, and not every teacher everywhere around the world is familiar with some of these concepts. But what are the areas that teacher-led classroom assessment really excels at? First of all, alignment with learning objectives and classroom practice. You know about your learners, you know about what you're doing, this is the right test. You can make those judgments really well. Less test anxieties. Learners usually feel better about being assessed by their teacher who they know than they feel about being assessed by others. And less exam preparation, because you can sort of, it can cut more into the flow of the less of the curriculum. So good points, bad points. What about standardized summative assessment? So let's begin with the not so good point. It can be distant from the context, maybe, depending on the test you choose, depending on how you do it. There may be a potential impact of preparation, the famous washback, where the impact of the test is that it somehow dictates what happens in the course, or more than you would expect. And the results are only meaningful if they're interpreted. If I just tell you, you got a B, what do I do with a B? Well, a B, if you don't do the work that this is what a B means, look at how you did in writing, look at how you did in reading, these are your strengths and weaknesses, it may have a different kind of impact. But on the plus side, very solid reliability if it is a good test, comparability of results, you can compare to other learners, to learners everywhere around the world, to throughout different cohorts over the years, very strong recognition, again, if you choose the right exam, and a very clear definition of levels of achievement. If your levels of achievement are defined through the CEFR, then you have a very specific definition of what you're getting at each level and what they actually mean. So do we have to choose one or the other? Is one everything you need? Not really. The key is the yin yang, a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and managing the dynamic balance between those two. Assessment for learning is not about formative assessment. Assessment for learning is about the right kind of assessment at the right moment as a system of assessment that connects with the teaching that you do. So the yin and the yang, and a little bit of the black in the white, and a little bit of the white in the black, and this dynamic shape kind of brings together the ideas that we wanted to do. So time for another poll. At this stage, how confident about assessment for learning are you now? So option one, I can explain it to others. Option B, I have some idea about what it is. Option C, assessment for what? So tell me how you feel about this. I'll give you a couple of seconds, and then we will look at basically how well I have done. So what do the results tell me? I have lost my poll. So I can explain it to others, 46%. I have some idea about what it is, 51%. Assessment for what, 3%. Oh, you make me feel great. Thank you, you're an incredible audience. Thank you so much for that. But basically, the reason we have these two polls, and Alberto is going to go into that right now, is that the questions that we ask in assessment, like these polls, are going to give us a number of different kinds of information. So, Alberto, take it from here.
Thank you very much, Pablo, for bringing up such important points. Well, there are two things I'd like to highlight from the points you brought up here, Pablo. One of them is assessment for learning helps in making understanding and knowledge visible to learners, right? So it's central to the practice of assessment for learning. The concept that students who truly understand and are involved in their learning will experience accelerated rates of achievement. So in order to illustrate that, we are going to focus on some practical activities that can be used. Well, in this slide, we're going to look at an example of a portfolio activity. So the portfolio activity is something that can be done for a period of time. So it is a compilation of academic work which describes the student's journey, right? We are going to start from a big example of a practical activity, and then we're going to break it down to smaller examples. So this slide here has a lot of information, so we need to contextualize the information. So a portfolio, as I said, is a compilation of academic work that you can do for a period of time. So what you can do is you can ask students to keep a portfolio. You can find a sample and you can share a sample so students can have an idea of what a portfolio is like. Then for the activities that you set that students are going to include in their portfolio, we need to consider creating criteria. So here we have an example in the image of criteria for a portfolio, but the criteria that we have there, and we did this on purpose, is full of points. There are many points in this criteria because it was designed for portfolio for a certain context, for example, students in higher education. But if we are working with different age ranges, what we can do is we can adapt this criteria for the portfolio and reduce the number of points and narrow things down to more specifics. And these are decisions that you as a teacher can make together with the learners. You can consider the kinds of tasks you're going to set. For each task, consider success criteria. Our colleague Miranda Hamilton this morning gave a beautiful session on creating success criteria for learners. So you can refer to this session for more information. And then this you can share with the learners, and learners can use this criteria for self-assessment, but also for peer assessment. And you as a teacher can use the criteria to give students more individualized feedback on their progress, right? So another example, and here we are going to break down this information. We talked about portfolio. The other example in terms of self and peer assessment strategies. Yeah?
Looking on for a 5-minute warning. Okay. Okay, I'll go back on.
All right. Thank you, Johnny. So another example in order to break this down, we talked about a big example, which is a portfolio full of activities. If we think of more practical individualized activities, we can consider, for example, using the traffic lights. Some of our colleagues presenting in this Cambridge Live Experience event talked about the traffic lights as well. They are very, very useful as a self-assessment instrument, but also as peer assessment instrument. And basically, we use the colors in the traffic light for students to self-assess. And when you ask them a question or when you ask for their own feedback on a task that you set, like a speaking task or writing task, they can say whether they are doing okay, they feel confident about it, whether they are just okay, or whether they are stuck and still need more clarification. This can be done, for example, immediately in the class. The students could either use their hands, as we can see here in the illustrations, or they could have colored cards in order to signpost how they are feeling at this moment. So this is a very easy, practical instrument that can be used both in face-to-face teaching and in remote teaching as well. There are many types of self and peer assessment strategies that are visual. And we can also develop a bit more on those practices and consider another type of activity for self and peer assessment, which we call two stars and a wish. And we're going to show you an example of the two stars and a wish. Two stars and a wish can be used for self-assessment, for peer assessment, and basically learners have to consider two good points about a task that they have done, and they also need to consider one wish, something that they want to work on or they want to suggest peers that they work on in their piece of work or in their presentation, or in this specific exercise on a language area you have been working with the learners. So two stars and a wish are also a variation of the traffic light, and it's particularly good for peer assessment, right? Well, there are many variations to those types of activities. We can see, for example, you can use highlighting as a strategy. You can use so far, that is, how are you feeling so far? And maybe you can consider a continuum instead of the traffic light. So learners can put like from 0 to 10, how they are feeling. You can also use thumbs up, thumbs down, which is very good for young learners, especially if you're doing remote teaching. So thumbs up, thumbs down are very easy to express. And also emojis or smiley faces, that can be a variation of 2 stars and a wish as well. So we are now going to look at the assessment for learning journey, right? So when we look at what Pablo described, this combination of formative and summative assessment, and when we look at some of the practices that we described here, we can see that assessment for learning is like a journey, right? So we can start with simple things like traffic lights, and then we can develop to a more elaborate kind of assessment, peer or self-assessment, which is 2 stars and a wish. Or we can consider a period of time, we can consider a length of time for learners learning, which is the portfolio. And then the end of term or the end of the academic year ends with summative assessment. What we have here as a result of this journey is, well, using assessment for learning activities like the ones we have described, they're good because they encourage reflection. It's good to set goals, and it's a process and it helps with progress, right? Also, when we look at activities that are more elaborate for self and peer assessment, we see that this is a journey, and we cannot disregard the fact that this is a construction, just like the teachers who were feeling really lost in April, and then they were feeling a bit more positive in June. So they also foster critical thinking, because when you give the learners the moment to reflect, you give them tangible criteria and they have to self-assess using the criteria or assess their peer work. This promotes critical thinking. Also, when we think of assessment for learning for a period of time, it's longitudinal. We are not looking at learners in specific moments, but we're looking at how they are progressing from a period or a period of 3 months, a period from the beginning to the end of the semester. It provides learners with less teacher input and more student production, which is what we want at the end of the day. And all those discussions that you do with the learners, giving them feedback, eliciting feedback, also is also part of student production, right? So for a period of time, what you get at the end is a record of what students have done during lockdown. This could be a suggestion, so a portfolio of what they have done during the lockdown period, and you can use that to diagnose areas to work on. So that can become diagnostic assessment. And then you can continue the portfolio between now and the end of the course, which means that if you are beginning the academic year, you can set a deadline for you for portfolio submission, or if you are moving towards the end of your academic year, you can set the end for this submission. And just to round things off for now, I'm going to end with a statement from a song by a Brazilian composer. And this is a free translation of the song, which was written in Portuguese. It basically says, "The arrival train is the departure train." Okay, how does, what has this got to do with assessment for learning? Well, analyze your objectives, especially after this period of lockdown. You might need to revisit the objectives because your original objectives may have been impacted by the situation, right? Then you can go to the next step, which is prioritize and choose. Pablo gave a clear example of choices, 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 right? And then build checklist of things to cover, things you need to work on. And next, design tasks and also design the criteria. Then deliver feedback. When you've designed tasks and criteria, set the tasks and also deliver feedback that is actionable, that is frequent, and that is rich for learners, and then respond, right? Respond to the results and rethink the next steps. And then this is where we connect with the statement, the arrival train, the departure train. You start all over again. It's the do, review, learn, apply cycle, right? I think with that, Johnny, we are ready for questions.
Yes, surely. I think that was great. You've received amazing comments, and I personally enjoyed that presentation a lot. Some nice comparisons and analysis of assessment from real world examples. I like that. So I'm going to pick hopefully two, perhaps three if we have time. I've got one question, which is I thought was quite interesting, and it was asking about how can we change the student mindset in terms of how they feel about assessment, because they often feel like it's a bad thing and it scares them, whether it's formative or summative. So I wonder if you could explore that.
Can I say something, Pablo, to start with? I love this question. And one of the premises of assessment for learning is that the teacher has to believe that the learners will make progress. If teachers do not believe that learners will make progress, so assessment for learning will not have a connection with the teaching practices. So I think this is the starting point. We want learners to be motivated, to be involved and engaged with their learning, but it's important that we believe in the first place that they are going to make progress and involve them in this process.
Exactly. And whenever we talk about mindsets, we need to go back to basically the work that Carol Dweck has done on mindsets and talking about the fixed mindset and the growth mindset. So there is a lot, well, there is a whole book about it, and there are tons of talks and webinars and things. And even within this conference in the Cambridge Live Experience, we have had sessions talking about mindsets. So go back to those. But basically, a fixed mindset is the idea that I was born with certain skills. I have these skills, I am good at this, I am not good at that, and that is not going to change. I cannot fly because I will never grow wings. I cannot learn English because I'm bad at English. And a fixed mindset, that kind of idea, is very difficult to work with, because if you do bad in a test, it confirms that I suck. If you do really well at a test, it is just, well, I knew I was good, but this is not giving me motivation to carry on. It's just confirming my previous idea. And actually setting a challenge for me. So we reinforce and rebuild mindsets in everything that we do in the classroom, but particularly in how we approach feedback and assessment. Feedback can be information that tells you how to go and reinforces. Always begin from the things that you are good at. This is what you've done well, and then move to how you can improve. It can be a judgment, you are bad, or it can be a sentence. You are bad, you will always be bad, you have failed. So within those three, we have a lot of choices in the things we say, the things we do, the things we approach, and it is something that we do in every single moment we teach. It is perhaps one of the greatest challenges in education. How can I convince you that you can improve? How can I show you how to improve? And how can I guide you along the way? That's basically the job.
We can start by making choices with two stars and a wish.
I think that's a nice staggered framework. That's a good idea.
It's a great point. And also two stars and a wish. So I'm going to focus on your stars first, and there are going to be twice as many as the things that you can improve. So that kind of message is already setting you on a positive path.
And so we mentioned challenges there. I've got a final challenging question for you as to whether we need to do this or not. But the question says, how can we make our students understand that formative assessment is actually assessment? Sometimes I feel it's just another task or project and they don't devote enough time or study enough for it, which I thought was quite a good question. So I'll leave that with you two.
Okay. It's a really good question, because it has to do with mindset, or it has to do with the role of that we give assessment in the teaching. If we focus everything that we do on the way we build the curriculum and the things we tell our students about, this is about helping you improve and working on your skills and knowing how to get to where you want to go. It is a very different message from, I only bother with it if it is a test, it comes with a number, and that number goes into my report card. So if we start paying less attention to numbers and grades, actually in terms of the kind of feedback that is really important, the assessment for learning group worked a lot on what kinds of feedback were useful, and the least useful, the least impactful, and the least constructive kind of feedback was actually grades. A comment is better than a grade. Written feedback with some kind of 2 stars and a wish kind of thing is better than a grade. Anything is better than, I'll just give you a number and focus on that. So don't worry too much. I know that educational systems are built around every 3 months you get a number, and at the end of a year, we average those numbers and you pass or fail. But the more we can keep what happens in the classroom every day far from that kind of structure, that kind of idea, and say, in the classroom, we're going to focus on giving you information about how to, what your strengths are, what your weaknesses are, that is going to help. And actually, if learners start to value the formative feedback, they're going to value the formative assessment and start focusing on that. This is my chance to shine. I don't know, Alberto, if there's anything you feel I've left out.
Yeah, I mean, numbers out of context will not mean much for learners, for teachers, or for education and society, like the parents, for example. It's very important to consider that in education, we have our long-term goals, which are the goals we have to meet by the end of the term or by the end of the year. And then we have the short-term goals, which are the goals that we set for every lesson that we teach. So it's very important to start building in students' mind the idea that one activity that you set in the lesson today will lead them to that major goal, because that activity will help them develop X, Y, or Z skill or competency in order for them to meet the major goal. So usually there is this view that the activities are disconnected from the goals, when in fact they are part of a whole, and it's very important to build this awareness in learners that they're doing this activity, what's the goal of this activity, and how it will help them achieve the major goals, not only the learners, but also the teachers, the institutions, etc. So it is a construction, and we need to start making learners aware of this. So when you set a short-term goal, they do the task, and then you get them to analyze self-assessment, peer assessment in relation to that activity, and making them aware that it's part of a whole. It's not something done in isolation. It's not a picture of a moment only.
Lovely, thank you. I don't think we've got any more time for questions. We've had lots of questions in the chat asking if this is the last session today. And I'm sorry to be the breaker of bad news that it is. This was the final session of our 3-day online experience. We've had 25 sessions, 10 Inspire sessions, and more than 30 speakers from around the world. I would like to add a special thank you to the people behind the scenes that you haven't seen throughout this. They've been working incredibly hard and have done, so maybe a virtual clap from across the globe. It would be nice to see that for, I'm going to name a few. There were more than likely many more, but Natasha, Aaron, Angela, and Amy have been fantastic throughout all of this. So a big thank you. You've been amazing. And also you guys, thank you for joining us from across the world at ridiculous times in some areas, or some people have probably seen every session and are just waiting for that weekend to maybe chill a little bit. But thank you so much. This wouldn't be anything without you. So we're glad, and it really makes us happy to see those comments saying that you found these sessions useful, that you'll be going back on YouTube, for example, to check them and to share with colleagues. It's lovely to see that. So thanks from the bottom of our hearts for that. And we do hope that you've found it useful, and that you feel ready to return to class, whenever that is, or in whatever form it is. We hope that these 3 days have done something and have added something to your teaching toolbox to make that a less bumpy journey once you're back in the classroom, whether that's virtual or face-to-face. And with that, I think we're drawing this to a close. Have a lovely weekend. Once again, thank you, Alberto and Pablo. That was a fantastic presentation.
Thank you, John, and thank you, everyone involved.
And yeah, see you next time. Bye.